Hello, Council and Budget Committee. I am Mary Bridget Smith. I am your city attorney, and I'm presenting the budget tonight for legal services for the city of Springfield for FY21. I love doing city attorney work, and I am proud of our office, so I look forward to speaking with you tonight about our department and our budget for the coming year. This slide shows a summary of our services. The main purpose of the city attorney's office is to advise the city to stay compliant with the law and to minimize legal liability. We are advisors and advocates to the city, but not necessarily litigators in the traditional sense. For example, our insurance company, City County Insurance, will handle lawsuits that involve property damage or employment claims, whereas we will do advocacy for administrative things like the Land Use Board of Appeals, some litigation in Lane County Circuit Court, and then obviously being at City Council and Planning Commission meetings. One thing that's different about the City Attorney's Office is that the City Attorney is in a direct appointment of the Council and directly accountable to the Council. We are also a small department, one City Attorney, one Assistant City Attorney, and one Legal Assistant. This slide shows our proposed budget summary. The city attorney's office has three FTE with no anticipated changes in the upcoming year. We are a general fund department. Legal services does also include the city prosecutor contract. That is a contract with a private firm named Leahy Cox. They have been our prosecutor for approximately 7 years. They are not employees of the city. Their role is to represent the city of Springfield for criminal misdemeanors that occur in the city limits and that are brought before Springfield Municipal Court. If you look at the first line of our budget, personnel services, you'll notice that it starts in FY19. That's because that's the year we came in-house to serve as in-house city attorneys. Looking at the second line, materials and services, that essentially represents the cost of the city prosecutor contract and then overhead for the city attorney's office and then any prosecutor overhead because they're housed over at the Justice Center. You'll notice that in FY20, there was an increase. We had to hire some contracted legal services to help us this past year while I was serving as the city manager pro tem. And turning to our accomplishments in the past year, I did serve as city manager pro tem while the council was recruiting Nancy Newton, our new city manager. So that was a big chunk of my year this past year. But we did do some legal representation for the city, divided that into two categories for you, proactive legal representation and traditional legal representation. An example of proactive legal representation includes when our assistant city attorney, Christina Kraz, assisted with the development code project for the transportation system plan. This was the project where code was developed that implements the council's policy on transportation law. It was adopted and reviewed by the Planning Commission, City Council, and Board of County Commissioners. And she served on the project team from the very start. So she was able to advise on draft code, substantive areas of transportation and land use law, and then also on the procedural aspects of how to best get that project adopted and move it through the process. This is the kind of an example that where an in-house city attorney can really be effective to be able to work on projects like this, as opposed to reviewing them after the fact. Looking though at other legal representation, what we will call traditional legal representation, we still did a lot of work like that for the city over this past year. This is the kind of work you think more of lawyers doing. This is helping a client solve a problem, address a challenge. Some examples that are shown on this slide include, we had a sewage spill in a neighborhood this year. So we filed an action in Lane County Circuit Court asking the court to order the homeowner to stop the spill and help with cleanup costs, and then drafted some code changes on nuisance abatement that will help us in the future, sort of a lessons learned that if the situation happens in the future that we can react more efficiently. Another accomplishment this year was ushering through with staff and council a contested zone change application in the Gateway area. And then a validation action, which was a lawsuit that we filed on behalf of CETA, who involved an amendment to the Glenwood Urban Renewal Plan, which will extend the life of that plan and allow the agency and the city a longer opportunity to bring economic development to that area. Looking out to FY21, we think there are three areas where we'll be looking at our initiatives. First, we think there will be a lot of work and legal issues involved with economic development and recovery. Obviously, with COVID-19, we have a lot of community recovery efforts coming our way, federal and state legislation to better understand. And then the council has identified three economic development goals, and we also see an area to assist there with bringing those to fruition. Another area where we see that we'll be working this coming year is to assist in the transition of a new city manager, Nancy Newton. Really view that relationship between the council and the city manager and the city attorney as critical to moving initiatives forward for the city, and look forward to working with Nancy and getting to know her more. Another project that will be significant in the coming year will be the Development Code Update Project. Council has directed staff to rewrite our development code. This includes land use code about residential and commercial properties, and is a significant project. Christina is again on the project team for this, so she's helping with provide that substantive legal advice and that proactive advice that will help the project all along. And then we'll do the more traditional procedural advice about adopting the package. Looking further out beyond FY21, we still think we'll be doing a lot of work surrounding economic development and recovery. Depending on COVID-19, we are foreseeing continued assistance with the community recovery for that, and then also economic development. These are often long-term projects that take more than 1 year to complete. The Development Code project is also another project that will be more than 1 year, and we anticipate that Christina will be spending time on that this coming year. And then the last area that we're anticipating looking at is franchise and utility licensing. We are working to become subject matter experts in this area. This includes things like renegotiating our Comcast cable franchise, and then other items like 5G, fiber. Those are becoming more and more part of our community infrastructure. They're often located in city right-of-way. There's a lot of federal regulation that's involved in these items, but it's also a potential area for revenue for the city. So we're working on becoming, as I said, subject matter experts on that, so we can help the city and bring forward options to hopefully recover some revenue, but definitely stay compliant with federal law and move that infrastructure forward. That's the end of my presentation. I will be at the Budget Committee meetings, and I look forward to answering your questions and receiving your comments at that time. Thank you.